Afternoon. Can I remind members that social distancing measures in place in the chamber across the campus? And the first item of business is portfolio questions. In order to get in as many people as possible, use your mantra, short and succinct questions, and preferably answers to match. And the first set is economy, fair work and culture. And can I remind members that questions 2 and 3 have been grouped together. If a member wishes to ask a supplementary question, they should indicate so in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. And I'll take supplementaries at the end of both of the grouped questions. Question number 1, James Kelly, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to promote fair pay practices.
Minister Jamie Hepburn, please.
Presiding Officer, workers must be paid and paid fairly for the work they do. Fair pay is fundamental to fair work, and we're committed to promoting payment of the real living wage and employer accreditation. We've included payment of the real living wage in the criteria for our flagship Fair Work First policy, a key mechanism for driving fair pay in Scottish workplaces. There are now over 1,900 living wage employers in Scotland, and at 84.8% of employees, Scotland remains the best performing of all 4 UK countries in relation to the proportion of employees paid the living wage or more.
James Kelly.
Fair pay practices are the mark of a dignified society. Therefore, it is regrettable that some care workers have been left behind. These workers have worked in really difficult circumstances during the pandemic to support those that they are looking after. Therefore, can I ask the Minister what action the Scottish Government is taking to support the objectives of the GMB Trade Union campaign to secure care workers a £15 payment per hour for the work that they carry out?
Minister, please.
Thank you, President Officer, and I thank Mr Kelly for his question. Of course, the first thing I would observe is I absolutely share the perspective. We owe our care workers a great debt of thanks at all times, but particularly in the current context. I recognise that a proper remuneration for our social care workforce is important. In that regard, we have worked very closely with the sector and with COSLA and local government more widely to make sure that for those commissioned care services, all those who work in that sector are paid a living wage. And indeed, that includes resources over the last 2 years to cover the extension of real living wage to sleepover hours during 2018-19, and they will continue through this year. So we recognise the need that we have to play a role in ensuring social care workers are properly remunerated, and will continue to play that role.
I can say to the Minister, I don't know if anybody managed to hear that. I certainly couldn't determine throughout what was being said. Now, I'm not sure whether it's the Minister's connection or whether it's something to do with functions here, but we will check it out. But undoubtedly, I'll say to Mr Kelly to check the written reply, please, because I don't think that was clear at all. We'll see how we get on. A brief supplementary, Gillian Martin, please.
Thank you, President Officer. Can the Minister provide any further detail as to how the Scottish Government will apply its Fair Work guidance for public sector economic development, and particularly in Greenport?
Minister.
Having heard you, President Officer, I shall shout down the computer screen. Hopefully you can hear me better. As early adopters of Fair Work First, our enterprise and skills agencies have started implementation last year of our Fair Work First policy. We have, through writing to all public sector bodies last year, in December of last year, a joint letter from both Fiona Hislop and Kate Forbes, set out the expectation that all public bodies will be adopting Fair Work First criteria in their capacity as an employer from March this year, and from April this year, applying criteria to any grants, other funding or contracts they award. Very serious about this agenda. Indeed, as we take forward our Greenport plans, we're making sure that Fair Work First is a central part of that agenda as well.
I'm afraid it's your connection, Minister, so I'll ask Ms Martin to check the written answer. Unfortunately, that's the only one you're answering in here, so that's helpful. Otherwise, we'll all be on a bit of a mystery tour. Question two, Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what progress it has made in delivering the Young Persons Guarantee for 16 to 24-year-olds in the Glasgow, Maryhill and Springbourne constituency.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop, please.
Through our £60 million investment in the Young Persons Guarantee this year and commitment to a further £70 million investment next year, we're building on existing education, employability, skills and training infrastructure to provide new opportunities and enhance support to young people. The guarantee is based on the principle that local partners are best placed to identify and deliver the opportunities and support needed for young people in their areas and to respond flexibly to emerging challenges. In Glasgow, the guarantee will provide additional resources for local partners to strengthen provision for 16 to 24-year-olds. This includes extending existing activities such as the Glasgow Guarantee, their supporting growth programme for unemployed young people, and Glasgow Code Learning, as well as creating new opportunities through colleges and Skills Development Scotland.
Bob Dorris.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Just for clarity, if any 16 to 24-year-old is unclear as how to benefit from the Scottish Government's Young Persons Guarantee, can the Cabinet Secretary make clear the various points of contact they can reach out to make sure they secure this very welcome support?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, there's the Young Persons Guarantee website, which provides a range of opportunities on offer and additional points for young people and indeed employers. The Young Persons Guarantee builds on the strong foundation of support that's already in existence through, for example, schools, further and higher education to apprenticeships, training and employment. We've intentionally adopted a no wrong door approach so delivery partners from right across the different sectors can point people in the right direction. Developing the young workforce school coordinators are going to be particularly important, and the investment that we're providing is ensuring that all schools will be able to have a young workforce school coordinator, particularly for that group of people. But the local authority employability support offices, colleges and specialist service providers in the third sector all know and are prepared to point people to the umbrella of the Young Persons Guarantee to make sure that they get the programme or the development or the support or indeed the employment links that they need with their local employers to ensure that they can benefit from the Young Persons Guarantee.
Question three, James Dornan.
I apologise to the Cabinet Secretary, it's very similar content in this question. To ask the Scottish Government what progress has been made towards implementing the Young Persons Guarantee.
Cabinet Secretary.
Since we launched the Young Persons Guarantee in November 2020, we have created around 18,000 new and enhanced opportunities for young people aged between 16 and 24 to help them into work, education and training. This includes new provisions through local councils, colleges, new apprenticeship pathways and the third sector. Through the Scottish Budget, if it's passed, we will provide additional investment of £70 million to build on this, to achieve our ambition of supporting every young person with a focus on those we know have been hit hardest by the pandemic. And working with Young Scot, we have established a leadership panel who work with us to help shape the guarantee and ensure that young people continue to be at the heart of its delivery. And we're also continuing to work with employers to gain their commitment to supporting young people as the economy begins to recover.
James Dornan.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. And surely the parties in the Parliament won't be mad enough to not pass a budget that's going to give an extra £70 million to help every 16 to 24-year-old across my constituency and constituencies all across Scotland. This should surely help to recover from the loss of opportunity brought about by the pandemic. But how do you see it helping to stop these young people from becoming a forgotten generation after the pandemic?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it's a very serious point that young people are likely to suffer most, particularly when furlough ends, and we're seeing quarter two, quarter three of this year seeing the increases in unemployment that we're expecting. And much as I would be tempted to get into a debate about the budget, actually, I think the Young Persons Guarantee deserves every single party, every single MSP support to enable people to have confidence in it, to encourage employers in their own areas to support the employers that are leading the recruitment, particularly for employment opportunities in every part of Scotland. So with that consensus, Presiding Officer, I will not be tempted into a political debate.
Two brief supplementaries, Annabel Ewing, followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And turning to the important issue of what's happening in the Kingdom of Fife, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to clarify what progress is indeed being made in Fife in implementing the Young Persons Guarantee as regards the number of young people benefiting? And can the Cabinet Secretary also advise as to how the Scottish Government is encouraging employers in Fife to sign up? Thank you.
I must redefine brief. Cabinet Secretary.
So I know Annabel Ewing is a great champion of Fife, but what was interesting when I spoke to the Fife Chamber of Commerce, that they are great champions of developing the young workforce, and we've used the model of that, and particularly the employer-led focus to ensure that the needs of local economies can be matched to the opportunities of young people. Indeed, the experience of the school coordinators in Fife was very instrumental in how we're rolling the Young Persons Guarantee out across Scotland, and using the resources from that to have that really vital school employer link through those the coordinators placed in every school.
And Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware of the UK Government Kickstart programme, which is available across the whole of the UK. And I wonder if she would agree with me that it would give our young workforce the very best chance if the Scottish Government worked with the UK Government Kickstart programme and get the biggest bang for your buck.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm very keen to work with the UK Government on this. I've already spoken, had a meeting with the Secretary of State, Theresa Coffey. One of the issues is to make sure that there's opportunities for local organisations and in local government to be leads in some of the coordinators for Kickstart. There are some issues from some local authorities, I think perhaps in the region that he represents, and perhaps he could take that up with the UK government as well, because those links are really important. What we want to do is provide a two-year programme. Kickstart's 6 months, but if you add the Kickstart together with the potential employer subsidy that will be delivered through the local employer-led council initiatives in each part of Scotland, you can really get a meaningful package that can make sure that these young people do not become, as James Doran said, a forgotten generation. Young people are our future, but they're also our present, and that's why we all need to pull together to help deliver on the Young Persons Guarantee.
Question 4, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how it ensures value for money when investing in private companies.
Cabinet Secretary.
The guidance contained within the Scottish Public Finance Manual outlines the Scottish Government's approach to investment in private companies. The guidance is clear that an investment must be supported by a clear economic and commercial rationale and must demonstrate value for money for the public purse. In support of these considerations, appropriate expert commercial and legal advice is provided as to the commercial aspects of the proposal.
Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. I'd like to welcome the news that two of the three BIFAB yards have been bought out of administration. However, it still leaves the question of whether the taxpayer will get our £50 million back. So in relation to BIFAB, the Economy Committee has tried and failed to get hold of the pre-acquisition business plan. Neither the government nor DF Barnes were prepared to share it, citing confidentiality. Ministers and DF Barnes signed a confidentiality and non-disclosure agreement, the terms of which expired on Monday. That means there's nothing preventing...
Yes, question, please.
I'm coming to it.
That no, you're not. You better do it now.
There is nothing preventing the Cabinet Secretary from releasing that agreement. Indeed. Now. Will she do so?
Thank you. You made your point in the lead-up. I knew it was. Thank you. Cabinet Secretary.
I wasn't sure because of the interruptions whether it was the business plan he was referring to or a commercial agreement. Now, the member will be aware that all governments have to work with companies in an area that will always have commercial in confidence issues, particularly when there's markets, listings, etc. I, in my evidence, made it quite clear that I thought that the business plan should be shared, the original plan, it should be shared, and but at that point, obviously, it's not our document, it's the company's document. So for a government to share another third party, a company's document, is an issue. But I will read his, because I, to be honest, I had difficulty catching exactly the tail end of your question. I will read it very carefully in terms of the dates and the considerations, and I will give it due consideration, because it was always my view that it would be very helpful to the committee had that business plan been published.
Mr. Simpson, read the tail end again, because I heard it, but just read your tail end, which I think was the point of the date.
Yes. So ministers and DF Barnes signed a confidentiality and non-disclosure agreement, and the terms of that agreement expired on Monday of this week. So my point was, there's nothing now preventing the Cabinet Secretary from releasing that, but she's answered the question. I appreciate she hasn't read the agreement, but she can go away and do that now.
I'd actually heard that. I thought the Cabinet Secretary heard a point about the debate, but it's cured. And a very brief supplementary from Kenneth Gibson, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that the Prime Minister wasted £940 million on vanity projects while Mayor of London, including £57.5 million on the subsequently cancelled Garden Bridge, Thames Estuary Airport, etc., and as Prime Minister authorised expenditure of £252 million on unusable face masks and £14.3 billion on botched outsourcing projects. Does she therefore agree that the Scottish Government has been a paragon of financial probity by comparison?
Cabinet Secretary.
So our public investment has been to save jobs, deliver public services and support communities. I think the member makes a very pertinent point as to judging governments and their investment. But on a more serious point, I think the questions that should be asked are those about public investments in private companies in relation to COVID contracts. And I'm sure in the light of day, all will be laid bare as to who profits and those connections. And I think the few have benefited from the hardship of many. And I think COVID contracts in particular will be one of the serious issues that have to be addressed by the use of public money in relation to private contracts.
Question five, Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And back to a sensible question, to ask the Scottish Government what the projected impact of COVID-19 pandemic is on the economy for the Highlands for the current financial year.
Cabinet Secretary.
Scotland's economy grew for six consecutive months, but the further restrictions on economic activity needed to suppress the virus led to a fall in GDP in November and a slight fall in December. The economy is recovering and continues to broadly track the UK economy as a whole. However, the recovery is fragile, will be gradual, and is subject to uncertainty about the impacts of Brexit. The most recent high business panel survey showed half of businesses in the Highlands and Islands are operating below the level they had been before COVID-19, and tourism businesses were more likely to anticipate a contraction in the next year or two. In the first 9 months of 2020, exports of Scottish food and drink, around a quarter of which originate from the Highlands and Islands, were down 22% compared to the same period in 2019. Dampening demand and new Brexit bureaucracy are presenting additional barriers to the previously free movement of trade. And we're liaising with local authorities and enterprise agencies to better understand the impact of COVID-19 and the wider action required to enable recovery in their local communities and wider regions. We'll continue to examine regional impacts to ensure that the specific needs of Scotland's regions are supported.
Edwin Mountain.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary, as you know, tourism is vital to the Highland economy. The Highland Council is still awaiting guidance from the Scottish Government regarding the Bed and Breakfast Support Fund announced on the 21st of January, which is a follow-on to the fund you announced last year. Now, the fund was meant to be open from the 15th of February. Can you, Cabinet Secretary, confirm that the money and the full guidance has been given to the Highland Council?
Before you respond, and I know it's easy to slip into this, but please don't use the term you. The only person is the member or the Cabinet Secretary. I know you understand that, Mr. Mount. It's an easy mistake to make. Cabinet Secretary.
So the impact on tourism has been very serious and extreme indeed. So, you know, one of the reasons why we're extending business rates for a whole 12 months in relation to retail, tourism and hospitality. There have been a number of schemes that have been specific in Scotland that have not been available elsewhere. I know the issue on B&Bs, particularly those that don't pay council tax, don't pay rates but pay council tax. And that's why this scheme is made available. As you might appreciate, I am not the tourism secretary. I used to be, but I'm not now. So I'll try and make sure that we can get the details of that scheme, the guidance and its availability. But it was due to be open. It needs to be open. We need to support the tourism business until such times as they can reopen safely. And it's absolutely essential that we all support our tourism industry. And I'm certainly looking forward to my staycation. And if he advertises it, potentially the Highlands and Islands. Thank you.
Question six, Colin Beattie.
To ask the Scottish Government how the Scottish National Investment Bank will support the economic regeneration of communities when the COVID-19 restrictions are lifted.
Cabinet Secretary.
At the same time as supporting businesses and communities as part of our immediate response to the pandemic, we're also focusing on our longer-term vision for the country. The second mission of the Scottish National Investment Bank, its place mission, is about investing in places and regeneration to reduce inequality and improve outcomes and opportunities for people and communities. And this mission will allow for investments in the kinds of communities in which people want to live and work, places that are good for health and wellbeing and which involve the local community.
Colin Beattie.
Can the Cabinet Secretary advise what support is being considered for local development trusts and high streets to help them survive the impact of COVID-19?
The member may be aware, but the Town Sector Action Plan review was published in February. Lots of very important ideas of what can be done to help redevelop our town centres. Indeed, I was on a quad call on this morning with Wales, Northern Ireland and the UK government looking at city centres and town centre regeneration. We've established a place-based investment programme in Scotland backed with £105 million for 21-22 and also an empowering communities programme to help that. And there's a budget there of £13.6 million. And members may be interested that Community Development Trust, for example, who are very involved in the high streets and local areas, as I think he's indicating, can apply for that funding.
Brief supplementary, Alec Rowley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Whilst a place programme is welcomed, should we be looking at a people programme? What are the major barriers to regeneration in communities? And much of that has to come round about skills and supporting people to access employment. Are we looking at that?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the Scottish National Investment Bank, which was the introductory question, would not necessarily be in that area. We've got plenty organisations and funding, and indeed the £1.1 billion jobs and skills allocation in this year's budget is precisely for that. But I think the member's reflecting on the local aspect of that and regeneration, and that's why identifying the economic drivers within our towns to make sure that our colleges, our young persons guarantee, and all those aspects can be aligned to local employers and local places. And I think he's right to draw attention to that localism and that aspect of where regeneration can come from, and we've got to invest and support our people. We cannot go back to the situation that we had in the 1980s of mass unemployment, but with no opportunities for those young people, or indeed other members of our society, to recover in good locally based employment opportunity.
Question 7, Julian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it will ensure better economic resilience in the North East post COVID-19.
Cabinet Secretary.
So while suppressing COVID-19 and ensuring the safety of Scotland's workforce is our priority, we must also sharpen our focus on rebuilding for the future. We have an opportunity to invest for the future and design an economic recovery that works for all of Scotland's people, that delivers wellbeing, sustainability and fair work. And we are working with partners in the North East to deliver this through our £62 million investment in the Energy Transition Fund and the £125 million investment in the Aberdeen City Region deal.
Julian Martin.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. There's a great deal of technical and engineering knowledge in the North East due to decades of an economy largely dependent on oil and gas, as she knows. How can we ensure that this talent and expertise is built on as we prepare to transition to low-carbon technology, and that workers will not find themselves having to pay for expensive retraining and recertification when they have transferable skills already?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it's essential that we have a just transition as we move from carbon-based developments into renewable energies in particular. The National Transition Training Fund, again, has continued funding into next year precisely for the opportunity to reskill and upskill. The member refers to costs, and that's part of the support to ensure that those costs can be supported. But she also spoke about transferable skills, and I think some the piece of work that's identified for matching of pre-existing skills and transferability should be part of that, as well as matching in terms of employment opportunities. And I come back to the point about the real opportunity for the North East to be a powerhouse in terms of how it approaches a variety of different areas and renewables. There's some very exciting work, for example, in hydrogen that she'll be aware of, and how can we make sure sure that that transfer of skills and individuals can be as easy as possible and to use that fantastic skill base in the North East to develop the economy of the future.
A very brief supplementary, Mr. Golden.
Thank you and appreciate it, Deputy Presiding Officer. Firstly, the SNP will end oil and gas trade support before the end of the year, and according to Professor Hazeldine, in evidence to the Economy Committee, Scotland does not have a clear industrial roadmap. Will the Cabinet Secretary commit to addressing these twin failures?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we certainly do have a programme for industrial development, not least in advanced manufacturing and indeed in those industries I've just referred to, and indeed the investment, the serious investment in terms of energy transition of £62 million I've just referred to for Aberdeen. The member might not be aware, but the UK government has made it clear as part of its roadmap to COP26 that it will be ending export support for oil and gas. We have engaged, and Paul Woolhouse, as the minister, has engaged with the oil and gas industry because we know that in terms of those companies that are transitioning, support for the transitioning work is really, really important. But I don't think he's aware of the more severe and large-scale reductions in export support that has been announced by the UK government. And clearly, much of the oil and gas industry, as he knows, is reserved. But perhaps he might want to take a closer look at that announcement as well.
Thank you. Question 8 is not lodged, so that concludes questions on economy, fair work and culture. We move straight on to questions on education and skills. I remind members who want to ask a question, put R in the chat function. Question 1, Joanne Lamont.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what additional support it will make available to out-of-school care providers experiencing financial difficulties due to the COVID-19 pandemic.
Minister Marie Todd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We recognise that ongoing COVID-19 restrictions and changes in demand for childcare have had an effect on school-aged childcare providers, which raises concerns about the sustainability of these essential services. Daycare of children and childminding services have been able to draw on a whole range of financial support made available by both the UK Government and the Scottish Government. In particular, the Coronavirus Job Retention Scheme, the Self-Employed Income Support Scheme, and the newly Self-Employed Hardship Fund. In addition, the Scottish Government made £22 million of dedicated support available to private and third sector nurseries and school-aged childcare services since the start of the pandemic. School-aged childcare settings, which are currently open for vulnerable children and children of key workers, can access the temporary restriction funds, which will total £11.4 million between January and March. In light of the reopening of the ELC sector from 22nd February, we are considering how best to utilise the temporary restrictions fund that's been identified for March, best support those in the school-aged childcare sector. In particular, as restrictions continue for school-aged childcare services, we recognise just how vital they are to the recovery of the economy, but also to children's outcomes and to supporting families. And we are determined to see them survive this period of restriction. Full details of future rounds of the fund will be made available as soon as possible.
I don't want anybody to take this personally, but, you know, short questions with succinct answers is terribly handy to get everybody through the questions. Joanne Lamont.
Thank you very much, and can I thank the Minister for that detailed response. Out-of-school care providers in Glasgow have contacted me to raise serious concerns they have about the very survival of the sector, with some providers facing collapse. And understand, although primary 1-3 children have now returned to school and more age groups will follow, out-of-school care providers can still only provide care to key workers and vulnerable children. If this is still the case, will the Minister look to change this as a matter of urgency, given the impact on parents and carers' capacity to work and the impact on the income of a sector which is already very hard hit? And will the Minister engage directly and seriously with representatives of these providers to ensure that all necessary action is taken to ensure they survive?
Minister.
Absolutely, I'm happy to give that commitment. We do recognise just how essential childcare providers are, and we know that they are very concerned about their sustainability and their ability to continue to offer what we consider to be an essential service. We do engage very regularly with the Scottish Out of School Care Network. We have my officials meet with them on a very regular basis, and they are included in some of the early learning and childcare sector recovery working group that we have, which meets on a regular basis. In terms of the reopening, we are taking a very cautious approach to the gradual reopening of services. As you're aware, only part of primary school is open, and we take regular advice from the coronavirus COVID-19 advisory subgroup on education and children's issues. We will continue to engage with the Scottish Out of School Service care network on those issues to ensure that services are able to fully reopen as soon as it is safe to do so, recognising the vital role that they play.
Question 2, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it plans to have with colleges and universities regarding the grading process for students who have been adversely impacted by recurrent lockdowns in their final year of study.
Minister Richard Lochhead.
The Scottish Government expects universities and colleges to be mindful of the continuing impact of COVID-19 on students and their studies, ensure that there is fairness to all learners, and maintain the integrity and credibility of qualifications. My immediate priority is to enable final year students in colleges and universities to complete their studies and to allow them to move on to further employment or further studies. And I want to thank students for their patience and understanding as we work through the best and safest way to do that. To support this priority, I have established a short life ministerial learner journey task force with the aim of moving in a rapid and agile manner to collectively provide solutions and to address issues now facing students as a result of the extended disruption to learning and teaching caused by COVID-19 restrictions.
Bill Kidd.
I thank the Minister for that response. I've been contacted by constituents who are in their final year of study and have struggled immensely with working from home, minimal access to libraries, little or no face-to-face teaching or seminar discussions. The effects have been particularly hard on students who are parents of young children, as well as those in difficult living circumstances and poor quality and cramped housing. Given the adverse impact of the current lockdowns on undergraduate studies, has there been any indication that first and 2.1 degree classifications will be adjusted this year in a bid to reflect the difficulties posed to students?
Minister.
Well, Bill Kidd has outlined very well some of the challenges facing some of our students in Scotland at the present time. And as autonomous institutions, each university is, of course, responsible for its own assessment policies. However, saying that, we absolutely fully expect institutions to adopt a very fair approach to assessments, which supports students in attaining the qualifications they do deserve, despite the challenges faced as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic. Indeed, University of Scotland, on behalf of all 19 higher education institutions, have published a statement that seeks to reassure students that fairness will continue to be a defining feature of the assessment processes for the current academic year. And that statement explains that all institutions are carefully reflecting on their policies for assessment this year, including procedures to recognise and mitigate exceptional circumstances that may otherwise adversely affect individual students' performances.
Brief, am I still? I was drifting there. A very brief supplementary from Jamie Green, please.
Thank you. The Minister will no doubt have read with interest Professor Jim Scott's report into last year's grading process, which identified a number of systemic failings in governance. So can I ask whether or not the Scottish Government will allow experts such as Professor Scott to independently inspect the frameworks overseeing this year's exams and awards processes to ensure that we don't see a repeat of last year's shambles?
Minister.
The Scottish Government will continue to take advice from appropriate experts in the field, and indeed the universities are working hard on this issue. But as I explained, the universities are autonomous bodies and are responsible for their own assessment processes, but I think it's fair to say they've understood the desire from members of Parliament and society at large to ensure that our young people are not disadvantaged by the pandemic.
Brief supplementary, Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In addition to thinking about this year, students will be thinking about next year. So can the Minister outline what discussions he's had to ensure that students can return to face-to-face learning and that virtual learning is minimised for the next academic year?
Minister.
Thanks, Daniel Johnson, for that question. I mean, clearly the
The Short Life Task Force that I mentioned in my original response to Bill Kidd is looking at all these issues, not just the very, very short-term issues of helping students at the moment to complete their courses and make sure that they're supported should any of them require to repeat next year, but also to look at any potential consequences for the next academic year and the next cohort of students. So the task force will be looking at that, but clearly in terms of when face-to-face will return, that very much depends on the course of the pandemic in Scotland. As the First Minister outlined yesterday, it's making very steady and positive progress to ensuring that we can have the return of students to our campuses, hopefully sooner rather than later.
Thank you. Question three, Gordon Lyndhurst.
To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to decrease class sizes and reduce the prevalence of multi-level teaching.
Cabinet Secretary John Swinney.
President Officer, average class sizes in primary schools have been decreasing and are now at the smallest level since 2012. There are now more teachers than at any time since 2008, and the ratio of pupils to teachers is at its lowest since 2010. We have committed to investing over £300 million in education recovery over 2020-21 and 21-22. That has helped to recruit an additional 1,400 teachers and over 200 support staff. These additional staff may be used to reduce class sizes where appropriate. Multi-level teaching has long been part of Scottish education, and teachers are well skilled to take account of the needs of their pupils.
Gordon Lyndhurst.
Cabinet Secretary, just last week, the Scottish Conservatives revealed that almost 40% of Edinburgh schools were teaching classes which combined three or more year groups. Shockingly, 17% are teaching four or more. This SNP government is failing my constituents. What is going to actually be done about it?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think Mr. Lyndhurst, I think, ignores the fact that multi-level teaching has long been a part of Scottish education. And one of the reasons for that is to enable young people to be able to exercise as much choice over the subjects and options that they pursue, because inevitably, the broader the choice, there can be very small groups of pupils involved. Now, if Mr. Lyndhurst is saying that we should reduce the choice that's available to pupils, then I'm not prepared to sign up to that. What I want to do is to maximise the choice available for pupils, which of course is far more extensive in the subjects and options that are available to them today. And schools are best placed to make judgments about how that learning and teaching can be delivered sustainably within different parts of the curriculum. And I trust the teaching profession of Scotland to make those judgments.
Brief supplementary, Ian Gray, please.
Thank you. If we are to reduce class sizes and the prevalence of multi-level teaching, we need the new cohort of teachers entering the profession in the next school year, but their training will have been disrupted through disruption to their teaching practices. What support has been provided to them to help them as they enter the profession?
Cabinet Secretary.
There's very extensive and pragmatic discussions going on between initial teacher education providers, the General Teaching Council and local authorities to make sure, and obviously with cooperation with individual schools, to make sure that trainee teachers are able to secure the necessary teaching experience. Some of that has been delivered through remote learning, which is obviously a very different concept to the normal face-to-face teaching environment. But that work is underway to make sure that individual students are supported so that they can continue to make their contribution to the teaching profession. Last year, when we faced an abrupt end to the school year, there was arrangements put in place to make sure that students were able to make that contribution, and I'm confident the same will be the case in this academic year.
Question four, Gail Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what impact the COVID-19 pandemic has had on the Developing the Young Workforce programme.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
As with many areas of government policy, COVID-19 has resulted in changes to the way we have implemented Developing the Young Workforce programme. Since the outset of the pandemic, we have prioritised working with partners and employers through our network of DY4U. The work is focused on the online delivery.
Minister, could you halt there? Sorry. It's like you're underwater. I know you're not, because I can see you're not. Could you put your visuals off and let's see if the sound improves? Would you be able to do that? And we'll start again with your answer, please. We don't need your question again, Ms. Ross, your first question. Just the Minister giving his answer to your first question. Thank you.
I shall start again, President Officer. Certainly the visuals may have improved, if not the sound. As with many areas of government policy, COVID-19 has resulted in changes to the way we have implemented developing the Young Workforce Programme. Since the outset of the pandemic, we have prioritised working with partners and employers through our network of DYW regional groups. This work is focused on the online delivery of activity to support summer leavers in 2020 and the creation of EDYW, the DYW Skills Academy, and Scotland's biggest payment scheme. The publication of the report from the advisory group on the economic recovery saw Sandy Begbie appointed to lead the Scottish Government's Young Persons Guarantee. An integral part of this is the rollout of the DYW school coordinators across Scotland. These roles are being funded by the Scottish Government and will help drive partnerships with education employers and be delivered by the employer-led DYW.
Well, it was only slightly better. We had hope initially, but it disappeared. Ms. Ross, if you want to ask your supplementary, then you can look at the written answers later.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll do that. I thank the Minister for that answer, I think. Can he tell me if any of the ways of working that we have become accustomed to throughout the past year will be used for the developing the Young Workforce Programme as we move forward?
Minister.
I certainly can. Through the programme, we've embraced a lot of different ways of working. We'll continue to do that, including virtual engagement and sessions with employers. As with many areas of activity, based use of technology to ensure we're geared towards a post-COVID way of working and ensure our young people's education continues to be relevant.
Mr. Hepburn, I suppose you've got to keep going for the official report, as long as the official report can make out what you're saying, because we certainly can't.
Okay. Well, I was nearly finished. Do you want me to start again or just finish?
No. It's not really your fault. I'm just thinking the best way to resolve. Just finish what you're saying and we'll hope the OR picks it up. Otherwise, you just need to write it.
And we are prepared for the future economy, is what I was going to say, Presiding Officer.
And there we end that little session with Mr. Hepburn. And we go to number five with Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Scottish Government, though perhaps not Jamie Hepburn, what discussions it has had with Orkney Islands Council regarding the reopening of schools?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Orkney Islands Council wrote to me at the end of last year in relation to the reopening of schools and early learning and childcare. My officials have also been in touch more recently about the new arrangements for phased return of some pupils from the 22nd of February. Orkney Islands Council, as a rural authority, make use of composite classes where pupil numbers are low. Decisions as to when composite classes will be used and or effective for learners and teachers need to be planned at school level. The long-term shared ambition of both national and local government remains to safely maximise the number of children and young people who are learning in schools as long as it remains low risk.
Liam MacArthur, please.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the response? While some senior phase pupils undertaking some practical subjects have been able to return to school this week, that is not the case for those studying for PE qualifications. With Orkney currently in level 3, some youth sport can still take place within the community, but the ongoing restrictions that apply to PE in schools make it very difficult for PE staff to work with pupils as part of the required teaching and assessment. Would the Cabinet Secretary or one of his ministers agree to meet with me to discuss what more might safely be done to enable pupils in Orkney undertaking PE qualifications to maximise their chances of securing the grades that they deserve?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm very happy to have further discussions with Mr. MacArthur on that question. Orkney Islands Council have raised with me the different circumstances that they face and then the guidance that we've made available for the resumption of face-to-face schooling from the 22nd of February. We have given flexibility to certain questions such as composite classes and the decisions that are left to local authorities to exercise flexibility about numbers that can be returned. When it comes to topics such as PE qualifications, obviously the national guidance applies, but I'm very happy to hear the points that Mr. MacArthur wishes to raise with me on this question. I am working very actively to try to secure the return of as many secondary school pupils as I possibly can do at the earliest safe opportunity to do so. And I hope that we may be able to advance some of the questions that Mr. MacArthur has raised with me as part of that process.
Question 6, Annie Wales.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its plans to help pupils catch up on lost teaching time.
Cabinet Secretary.
So the first part of my answer in relation to this question has to highlight the fantastic work of teachers and other professionals in the education system who've provided high quality remote learning during these very difficult times for school pupils around the country. It is vital that schools and local authorities are provided with the resources to support learners to engage with their learning at all times, as well as the required flexibility to tailor the support to local circumstances. We have already committed to £300 million of additional funding over this and the next financial year for safety mitigations that support in-person learning, as well as to accelerate learning recovery as part of a longer-term programme to enable children to be able to address the time that they have spent out of school. This commitment recognises the need to tailor support to the needs of the school community and, for example, has helped to recruit 1,400 additional teachers and to supply 60,000 digital devices to young people around the country.
Annie Wills.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. With the loss of full-time education, it's clear the pandemic has created a national emergency for our children. The Scottish Conservatives' catch-up plan to address this monumental challenge included several proposals, including a national tutoring scheme and a major drive to recruit 3,000 teachers. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm if he's willing to commit to any of these proposals?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm actually doing a number of them already. I don't need to wait to hear from the Scottish Conservative Party. We've recruited 1,400 additional teachers already, and I've provided local authorities with the flexibility to recruit more teachers should, in their judgment, those teachers be required to supplement learning. In addition to that, there is a national tutoring programme available through the eSchool, which is available to learners around the country. And, of course, local authorities and schools are already providing a very extensive programme of remote learning. And over the Easter holidays, many schools and local authorities will be involved in supporting young people in taking forward their education. So I'm always interested to listen to alternative proposals, but I can assure Annie Wells that there is a sustained amount of effort in place to ensure that these issues are properly addressed and that the learning of young people is supported around the country.
Question 7 is not lodged. Question 8, Daniel Johnson.
Apologies, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met with representatives of the Teaching and Education Union.
Cabinet Secretary.
We meet the teaching unions and organisations on a regular basis to discuss a range of matters relating to teachers and education. Those meetings provide me with a valuable insight on any issues and concerns that teachers may have. The teaching unions are also members of a range of Scottish Government education working groups, including the COVID-19 Education Recovery Group, which, of course, I chair on a weekly basis.
Daniel Johnson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. This week will be welcome to many teachers returning to the classroom, but with that will bring some trepidation. So I was wondering if I could ask the Cabinet Secretary what steps have been taken to improve access to PPE, training on infection control, and importantly, what steps are the Scottish Government taking to listen to feedback from teachers so these steps can be improved, especially as we look forward to returning further years to the classroom in the coming weeks and months.
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Johnson for his question. On any PPE that is required in a school setting must be available. It's one of the essential measures within the education recovery guidance. So in all circumstances, any requisite PPE must be available. On infection control, Public Health Scotland work closely with individual schools in relation to advising them about how to handle particular outbreaks should they emerge within individual schools, and to support in the identification of children, young people and staff that may be affected as a consequence of proximity tracing. And lastly, Mr Johnson asked me what measures are put in place to listen to teachers. I have direct dialogue with teachers through a number of different channels of communication. But the teaching unions, as I say, are represented on a range of Scottish Government education working groups. They have the ability to feed in the issues, and they do feed in the issues that are of concern to teachers. And their contribution has substantially informed the detailed guidance that's been made available by the Education Recovery Group. And I'm grateful to the professional associations for the thoughtful and substantive input they've made to identifying the issues of concern so that we can put in place mitigation measures that can address those concerns, which is a fundamental building block of having a safe education system in these challenging times.
Thank you. That concludes the question on education and skills. I want to say to the members in this session and in the previous session who couldn't hear clearly Mr. Hepburn's answers, I think the only way to resolve that is if you were to put those down as written questions, and I would ask if the minister could expedite the answers, as the official report could also not pick up the answers. It could not pick up what was being said online. So if you could do that, that'll make it clear. And, you know, that's, I think, the best solution for everybody here. Thank you very much. Let's shortly move on to the next item of business.